Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for this day. Lord, thank you for waking us up today. Thank you for getting us here safely, Lord. Thank you that your word goes forth with boldness, simplicity, and power, that it ministers grace to the hearers, Lord, and that it reveals your love in every word, every syllable. Lord, I thank you and praise you, Lord, that that you have your way in this place. And we give you praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, people do what they call thematic preaching, and they'll have a theme for a season, and I generally try to avoid those kind of things, but you know, it's easy to do. It's like for a preacher, it's low hanging fruit to preach on a season. It's very easy. But I'm thinking about New Year, but I really want to focus in on the new. I want to focus on the new, because the new is very, very important. Understanding the new is critical to our lives as a believer. Understanding the new gives us the revelation of what we inherit in the new birth. New is very, very important. I can't overemphasize it. But, you know, there are folks that talk about that new car smell. Everybody loves the new car smell. You know, it's something special. Angie and I, we talk about the new baby smell. You know, what a new baby smells like. It is just, I mean, you know, like, I remember when Isaac and Robin first brought Hannah here, and we all, you know, we were just like, you know, just really reveling in the new baby smell. You know, the smell that a baby has is something special, is something unique. And, you know, when my dad and I, we frequently have this discussion about cars. I don't buy new cars because I don't want to take the hit on depreciation. My dad doesn't buy used cars because he doesn't want to inherit anybody's problems. So in other words, you know, but those used cars are still new to us. You know, they may have been someone else's before, and occasionally they might have the problems that somebody had before, but it's new to us. And the thing is that in the natural, newness wears out. What things that are new get old. And I like to think, one of my favorite quotes is by Jeff Bezos, who is the founder and the CEO of Amazon. And he said, "Don't get addicted to shiny, because shiny doesn't last." And if you follow shiny, you'll never know contentment. But what I want to show you guys today is that there is a newness. There is a newness that endures. Amen. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Romans chapter 6, verse 4. Romans chapter 6, verse 4. And it says, "We were buried therefore with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in the newness of life." Amen. Walking in the newness of life. Walking. Present tense. Iterative process. Ongoing. Walking. Not walked. Past tense. Not even walks, present tense, but walking. That means that from now on, as long as you are in Christ, that you will walk in the newness of life. And that's what I like to call newness in perpetuity. Now, here's a sad truth, because you'll hear people say, I'm tired of this walk. I'm weary I'm weary in my faith. I'm tired. And this tiredness comes from not understanding newness. Because see, the thing is, something only gets old to you when it gets old to you. You know, one of the things that's really amazing to me is like my kids never get old to me. You know, they're as wonderful and as awesome as the day they were born. And they get more wonderful and awesome as they get older. Because you start seeing them developing their own personalities, their own likes and dislikes. You start seeing them absorbing the things that you've taught them, but they also start manifesting things that they're learning on their own. And so this is a newness that never wears off. They remain awesome. And that's the way our walk in Christ should be. It should always be new. It should be like the evergreen tree of our lives, that it never loses its leaves, that it never gets stale, that it never gets old. It's just always beautiful and it's always fresh. But the issue is, people stop walking in God's love and grace that saved them and begin walking in religion. And when you start walking in religion, things get old, because religion is old. And the reason why religion is old, the reason why it gets old, is because it's man-made. And everything that man sets his hands to, sooner or later, will get old. Everything that man does, sooner or later, it's going to get old. But, you know, and I like to think, you know, there's a song, and I love this song. It's by Jonathan Butler. It's Falling in Love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. I really am opposed to the concept of falling in love, because falling in love, supposes an accident, that I tripped, slipped, stumbled into this thing. But the thing is that love has to be intentional for it to work, because see, God's love is intentional. God didn't just happen to, you know, God was angry at us and he said, oh, you know, I changed my mind. No, God never stopped loving us. He never stopped loving us. We are created in his image and likeness. And I'm going to tell you something, that if you ever had a photograph of yourself, and especially like if you have like a photograph of you and like an ex-boyfriend or girlfriend or something, you know, and you get mad with them and you tear that picture, you know, to try to tear that person's image and likeness out of the picture. But it's like when you tear a piece of yourself off, that bothers you. I don't know about you. I mean, it bothers me. You know, if I happen to tear a picture and I cut off my arm, you know, I'm like, oh my God, you know, because that's me. It's a part of me. It's like something that's reflected of me on paper. Well, God is the same way. It's like we're created in his image and his likeness. And so God loves us intentionally, because he created us intentionally. But religion is man-made, and it's accidental. You know, it supposes from one end to the accidental, to another end to the fatalistic. You know, that whatever God wills, you know, que sera sera, because you know whatever God says is going to happen, and that's it. And I really have trouble with that, because people take the impact of prayer out of things when they say that. Because if you're praying and God has already made up his mind, if God has already said that this is what I'm going to do, and you're praying for something, that means that your prayers may or may not be answered. It's like basically you're getting on your knees and going to the Holy Ghost casino. Whatever the roll of the dice is, God, I have to live by that. And that's, you know, God ages things for the sake of maturity, but things never get old. If you look at in the case of Abraham in Genesis chapter 25 and 8, it talks about the death of Abraham, and Abraham died full of years. It didn't say that he was sickly, didn't say that he was blind, didn't say he was senile, didn't say he was crippled. He was full of years. And then if you go to Deuteronomy 34 and 7, and Moses, you know, it said Moses died with his eye not dim and his natural force not abated. In other words, Moses went to the grave as strong as he lived. That's the difference between aging and old. Because see, old things fall apart. But something can be aged and still be good. You know, the case study in that was when Jesus performed his first miracle at the wedding at Cana, and he turned the water into wine, and the master of the feast said, you know, wow, you know, who is it that saves the best wine for last? In other words, the best wine is the wine that had been aged. So Jesus not only turned water into wine, but he also handled some fermenting and aging in the process. Are you with me? It's like, so there are things that are age and not old. And I like to think of this too, like in the children of Israel, when they were in the wilderness, if you read in Deuteronomy chapter 29 and verse 5, it said that their shoes and their clothing never got old. They had been in the desert for 40 years, but their shoes and their clothing never wore out. It was just as clean and fresh as the day they had left Egypt. That's something. Because not only do you have the normal wear and tear that happens from clothing, but you're also out in the desert and the arid climate, the sandstorms. Then, you know, like you have winds and you have insects and you have all of these other things that are going on. And yet and still, none of it got over. Another reason why folks grow weary in Christ is because there are new wine poured in the old wineskins. My friend Ed Delf says that in order to have a new wineskin, you have to first have a new mind skin. In other words, you have to change your mind. And to be poured into it, to be new wine poured into a new wineskin. See, you understand, when you're born again, you become new wine. And you can't be poured into old wineskins. In other words, the thinking and the perceptions of your past are no longer going to work with this new self. That's why Paul said it's important that we be transformed by the renewing of our mind. In other words, we have to get our natural mind, which is the seat of our soul, lined up with our born-again spirit. This has got to happen, because if you don't have this, what happens is that if you're not renewing your mind, you're going to be subject to your old ways. Why is this important? Because, see, first of all, you can try to work things out in your own natural understanding, which is taking the new wine and pouring in an old wineskin. Or you can go back to old habits, or you can go back to old people. And all of these things will cause you to be frustrated, because you will experience failure in your faith. It's important that you are renewing your mind on a regular basis. Because without that renewing, you're gonna go back to old habits. The second thing is that you're saved by grace through faith. You're saved by grace through faith. It isn't the law that saves you. It's not the prophets that save you. It's not the poetry of the Psalms, the Proverbs, or the Song of Solomon. If Job can't save you, the prophets can't save you. But Paul wrote that it is the gospel that is the power of God unto salvation. So if you are saved by grace through faith, and then someone tries to disciple you by law, they are pouring your new wine into an old wineskin. They are taking a remnant of new cloth into an old cloth, which will cause the whole thing to tear up. And we have to be really careful that we don't slip back into the ways of the world or into the ways of the old covenant. Because there was no salvation in the old covenant. There was only the shadow of salvation. But salvation had not fully manifested itself. It had not shown up until Jesus came on the scene. And I love this. This is one of my favorite things, one of my favorite passages of Scripture. It's 2 Corinthians 5 and 17. And it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. You, in the new birth, become something that never existed before. You are a new race. You are a new species. You are a new type. You are a new class. You are something that simply did not exist before. But this is the part that I love, is that when the new comes in Christ, it comes to stay. God's newness never departs, but we have to guard our hearts and minds so that our perception of it never changes. Do you catch that? Because God's newness doesn't change, but see, our perception of it does. There's an old story, an old adage, old joke, or whatever you want to call it, where this man and his wife, they move into a house, and the lady is looking out of the windows at her neighbor's laundry hanging on the line. And every day she complains about how filthy her neighbor's laundry is. and I just cannot believe that day after day it gets dirtier and dirtier. And so the husband went out and washed the windows. The problem wasn't her neighbor's laundry, the problem was her perspective. We have to make sure, see, and this is the thing, we have to make sure that our perspective is seen through the lens of Jesus. If you don't see it through Jesus, you see it incorrectly. God's newness never changes. You know, it's one of these things that when you get a favorite sweater or a favorite jacket or a favorite pair of shoes or something, and no matter how long you have these shoes that, or how long you have this shirt or how long you have this jacket, that every time you put it on, it makes you feel good. There's just something familiar, something comforting about that garment. That's the way newness in Christ is supposed to be, is that when we put on Christ, it should always be new. It should always be a party. Just like, I mean, the feeling that you get when you're born again, man, it's like you're just on top of the world. You feel like everything has been washed clean, that your slate has been wiped clean, that everything is good, everything is brand new. That feeling is the feeling that you're supposed to have in your walk with Christ for all eternity. You know, it's not like you get saved and you feel great, you're feeling born again, you're feeling brand new, and you go through this, and then now you gotta go through this dark period. You got to suffer. You got to go through it. Bless you. got to go through it. And then you go to heaven and everything's okay. That's not the way it works. You know, Jesus said that he came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Abundant life is not lack. Abundant life is not oppression. Abundant life is not sickness. Abundant life is not, being yoked to anything. It's being free. And I've said this before, you know, Jesus said, he said, come unto me all you that are heavily laden and he says, and I will give you rest. He said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly at heart. And when I think about it, you know, Jesus said, take my yoke. And you know, but he says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is, when I think of the difference between the yoke of sin and the yoke of law and religion, I think of an encumbrance that's on your back and you're pulling a load that you physically cannot bear. That is man's way. That's what religion does to you. Religion psychs you out, makes you think that you have to do all of this work. Just keep pulling. Even though you're not going anywhere, that's okay. As long as you keep pulling, it's all right. But Jesus said, take my yoke upon you. So he's saying that we have to take on something. You know, the scripture tells us that we put on the new man. We put on the new man. We put on Christ. When we put on Christ, here's what happens. I have to get to my inner geek to tell you this story. Because, see, to me, the holy grail of transportation is the jetpack. Ever since I was a little boy, I wanted a jetpack. Why? Because you can fly. You don't need a car. You don't need an airplane. You just rev this bad boy up and off you go. You fly. That's what the yoke of Christ is like. Because you're putting on something that initially it may seem like it's a little clumsy. It may seem like it's a little tough to bear. But when you rev the thing up, and how do we walk in this newness? How do we walk in the newness? And that is very simple. Love. Love. Jesus came and said, a new commandment I give you. In John 13:34-35, he says, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another. By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, that you have love one for another. You have to catch this, because see, with a new covenant comes a new command. That the old commands will not help you walk out the new covenant. Because if you're stuck in trying to do all of the commands of the old covenant, you're going to find yourself frustrated. Galatians 2:21, it says, you know, I do not frustrate the grace of God. By trying to justify myself by the law. You have to, have a new command, a new understanding to go with your new covenant. Because if you're trying to live out something new by something old, you'll wind up messing the thing up. You know, I always think of like the Beverly Hillbillies. They got all this money and they moved to this fancy mansion in Beverly Hills, but they never left the ways of the hills behind. And it used to cause all sorts of mischief. You know, Ellie Mae and her animals, Granny and her moonshine, Jed and his honey. You know, these were things that people didn't do in Beverly Hills. See, if you are operating in your newness, yoked to your oldness, all kinds of mischief is going to happen. It just doesn't work. It doesn't work. And the new covenant is the key to new life. I mean, it's like we don't have to struggle with rules and regulations and rituals because now we have the revelation of his love. We have rest in his love. And so when we walk in this love, we walk in newness. When we walk in grace, we walk in his fullness. In other words, we begin to partake of everything that God had for us. And that's what we're supposed to be doing. It's, you know, listen, the life in Christ is not supposed to be, oh me, I'm just suffering for Christ. I'm suffering for Jesus. No. Because if you have to suffer, if it is God's will for you to suffer, then there was no need for Christ to suffer. This was the sacrifice once and for all that made us holy, that made us righteous, that brought us into reconciliation with God. In other words, there is no suffering. Yes, we have to endure some things. Jesus said that in this world you'll have persecutions. But he said what? Be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. Why can you be of good cheer? Why? Because he's done the suffering for you. He's done the suffering for you. And another one of my favorite scriptures, 1 John 4:17, he said, by this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. In other words, love perfected. Love perfected. Love perfected with us. Love perfected with us. In other words, when we're talking about perfection, we're not talking about flawlessness. Although God's love is flawless, but it's our love that is maturing. And perfection in Scripture pertaining to the saints means maturity, not flawlessness. Because that's the other thing too, if you get caught up in the yoke of thinking that you have to achieve this flawlessness, then that means that your salvation becomes an effort of works and not grace. Because you have to work to attain this perfection. No, you've been perfected once and for all. But what he's saying here is that this love is perfected with us. So what we have to do is we have to have confidence in this love. We have to have confidence in this love because this says that as he is, so are we in this world. How do we walk in grace? How do we walk in love? Having confidence in the fact that God loves us. And that we reflect and radiate that love by sharing it with others. And by sharing it with ourselves. In other words, you have to love yourself. That's what Jesus said in Matthew 22. He said, love the Lord God with all your mind, soul, and strength. He said, second command is like unto it, love your neighbor as yourself. You're commanded to love yourself. See, people, they don't like me teaching that because that, you know, says, well, you're not being humble because that's self-love and that's a sin. Jesus said it, not me. Walking in newness means walking in rest. It means walking without stress. And I want you guys to take this one thing away as you go into the new year, that when your past tries to influence your future, remind your past that it has no future. Got to keep moving forward. The reason your windshield is bigger than your rearview mirror is because where you're going is more important than where you've been. Keep moving ahead. There's a reason why prognosticators, forecasters, are more valued in the world than historians. Because what is to come is more important than what's behind. You know, they have all of these financial forecasters that watch Wall Street and they analyze the markets and they predict which way the markets are going to go based on the information that they have gathered from the past and coupling that or juxtaposing that with what's going on right now, and they come up with a future prediction. And the good prognosticators, the good forecasters, are highly paid and highly sought after. You know, and this is for me, you got to tell the world, the naysayers, the devil, that the baggage of your past is not going to destroy your future. And it's very easy to fall into that trap. I'm learning, y'all. I'm learning. Because it's really easy, especially when you, I deal with numbers. It's what I do for a living. And sometimes you look at the numbers and you just say, man, this is messed up. And sometimes you have to look beyond that. It hurts sometimes. It's not easy. But you have to look beyond what you see and look at what you know. I hope that bless you. sometimes things get tough.